don't know if this is the week of broken set announcements, but it looks like we're going to be getting Link Vrains Pack 2, but only in Japan.
Zima!
What's going on, guys? It's Simo. So today we're going to be talking about Link Vrains Pack 2. That's right, Link Vrains Pack 2 just got announced a few days ago, and this got a lot of people really excited because Link Vrains Pack 1 had such a tremendous impact on the current format that there's really a good justified reason that there'd be a lot of hype centralized around a new iteration of the Link Vrains Pack being released. So we're going to go ahead and look at why Link Vrains Pack 1 was so successful, and then also talk more about Link Vrains Pack 2 in depth. But before we get into that, I need to give a huge shout out to my newest YouTube channel members, as always. So big shout outs today to David, to Gamer of the Windwalker, and VZ Infamous. You guys are the reason that this channel is growing strong. And if you guys want to help support the channel through a YouTube channel membership, click the join button right down below the video, or check out the links in the description. You get that nice cool little Simo head next to your name in the comments, and it'll let you know you're showing your support. But without further ado, let's go ahead and get right into it. So, one of the biggest things is that with Link Vrains Pack 1, this is, in my opinion, one of the greatest sets ever released across both the TCG and the OCG, because it kind of was one of those sets that really just did everything right. Not only did it include just a ton of brand new monsters that made a tremendous impact on the format, it brought a bunch of archetypes back into competitive viability because of these new Link monsters, but it also reprinted cards that complemented those Link monsters that were very highly desirable, and from a TCG perspective, we would have loved to have the reprints that were available in the Link Vrains pack. Now, obviously that was over a year ago, and by comparison, we've had some of those reprints since, but we're going to talk about that a little bit later in terms of just what kind of cards were in there. I first want to talk about the Link monsters in the Link Vrains pack itself, because that's kind of, you know, the running theme here and why people got really excited. There was 20 Link monsters released in Link Vrains pack 1, and over half of these Link monsters made an impact on at least one strategy, or sometimes even multiple strategies, that brought specific decks back into the competitive forefront. And that's what we're going to go ahead and start with. So which cards really had an impact? Well, you have a card like Curious, the Lightsworn Dominion, which realistically was just the Link version of Lavabel Chain and helped make not only Lightsworn a viable strategy, but it also made other decks very useful because just having that Lavabel Chain effect to send a card to the graveyard really helped tutor and make a lot of decks really viable. And then you also had Gem Knight Phantom Quartz, which was essentially the heart and soul of the Gem Knight FDK, which is still viable to this day, by the way. And yeah, maybe a lot of people aren't too happy about Gem Knight FDK, but it was a viable strategy nonetheless. It still is, and it's still an incredibly powerful deck that would not have been able to function to the near levels of consistency it has now, if not due in part to Gem Knight Phantom Quartz. You've also got cards like Izzold, which is currently one of the most hated Link monsters in the game because it helps facilitate Goki and the FDK boards. But even if you take Goki out of the equation, Izzold is a generic warrior support Link monster. In any deck that plays warriors, whether you're playing heroes or ninjas or whatever warrior-based archetype you're playing, Izzold is just an absolutely incredible card. You've got stuff like Clefort Genius, which hasn't been like the most important card, but the thing about it is it helped facilitate some plays in decks like ABC or other machine-focused strategies that having those down arrows was very significant and allowed the deck to do some plays a lot easier than it wouldn't have been able to do otherwise. Then you've got cards like Zephra Metaltron and Heavy Metal Foes Electromite, which are basically the whole reason that Pendulum and Pendulum FTK were the strongest deck of the format, even considering the fact that we are in the Link era and Link summoning just in general was supposed to be taking over. Heavy Metal Foes Electromite was basically the sole responsibility for bringing Pendulum decks back into the forefront. And you can't really discount Zephra Metaltron either, because it helped facilitate your Vortex plays and had a pretty decent effect in its own right. So you gotta give credit where credit is due, and Metaltron ended up being one of the stronger cards out of the pack. Then you've also got a card that we have yet to have released, but it will be in the next couple of weeks, Alistair the Invoker of Madness. Now, the thing about Alistair is that I've got high hopes for this card because you have to realize in Japan, they have a lot of the invoked cards actually on their Forbidden and Limited list, and I'm pretty sure this Link monster is part of the reason for that, because when whether it's in with tandem with Sky Strikers or whatever it may be, I definitely think this is a very powerful tool for the invoke deck, for being able to not only give you more Link arrows, but being able to search invocation. Like, this card is incredibly, incredibly powerful, and I think we're gonna see a lot, especially the opening weekend, once Shadows in Valhalla is released. So that's kind of a quick overview of all the cards from the Link Brains pack that we've got thus far, and kind of the impact that they had on the game. But the thing about this is, and I think what frustrated a lot of people, is rather than getting the Link Brains pack here in the TCG, Konami decided to take it and kind of piece out the cards in the Link Brains pack to help bolster some of these other sets to help them sell better. I mean, we take a look at Extreme Force. Extreme Force had 8 of the Link monsters from the Link Brains pack. Cards like Heavy Metal Foes Electromite, Izzold, I mean, Zephra Metaltron, I think Curious was in there as well, I think Phantom Quartz. There was a lot of the Link monsters in Extreme Force. And if you take those OCG imports out of Extreme Force, what did you really have left in the set? I mean, you had Saryuja, I guess that's pretty good. You had some Mech Knights, I think you had Inspector Border, Mythical Beast Master Cerberus, so you had some okay secret rares, but nothing really just format defining. And the thing is, if Extreme Force didn't have a card like Heavy Metal Foes Electromite, Mythical Beast Master Cerberus would not have had nearly the notoriety that it did, because Heavy Metal Foes Electromite essentially pulled Mythical Beast Master Cerberus into the forefront, because without it, it wouldn't have really been viable for pendulums to be as powerful as they were. But because Electromite was in there, oh, guess what? Mythical Beast Master Cerberus was actually a very powerful card, and it made the best out of that. So from their perspective, I guess it made sense to throw these Link monsters in there to actually make Extreme Force an incredibly good set when we look at it back in retrospect. But then you've got some cards in the Link Brains pack that, you know, weren't winners, and not every card is going to be. I mean, you've got cards like the Shadal Link monster, the Evil Swarm Link monster, the Insector Link monster. There's a lot of Link monsters in here that weren't exactly the most appealing, but at the same time, they were put in sets that didn't exactly need them to help sell the sets. I mean, Flames of Destruction did not really need help when you've got cards like Infinite Impermanence and Ghost Spell. On top of that, also having the Nightmares, the set was already pretty good, even if you take Link Brains pack out of it. So that was kind of a set where they're like, well, we don't need to put the good ones in here. And the issue that we face now here in the TCG is that we're still missing like 5 of the monsters from Link Brains pack 1. I believe we're missing like the Prophecy Link monster, the Hieratic Link monster, and most importantly, I would say 3 of the most impactful and format warping cards out of the entire set. We're missing the Aeromage Jasmine Link monster, which isn't really too big of a deal because Phoenixian Cluster Amaryllis is banned, but arguably, if the card was not that good, they might not have preemptively banned Cluster Amaryllis in the first place, just in case they decided to release Jasmine, and then Plant FDK would just become just overly just abundant in our format, plaguing the format, and people would just have another FDK that they're completely sick of. Now, I don't know if plants are viable just as a Link spam deck on their own, even without the FDK, but it's definitely something that could happen, especially considering we have Lone Fire Blossom at 3. Then we have the Burning Abyss Link monster, and can you guys just imagine if this card had been released before the WCQs? Think about this. Burning Abyss was a competitively viable strategy for the North American, South American, and European WCQs, even without their Link monster, and their Link monster is arguably one of the most broken Link monsters in the entire set. So just imagine how the format would have shaped up if we would have had Cherubini available for us to play. Burning Abyss could have probably been one of the best decks of the format, and that's really not an understatement. Now, obviously I can say whatever I want because that's all in hindsight and we'll never know, but I really think that this card is that powerful, and the thing is, it's generic. You don't even have to play it in Burning Abyss. You can play it in so many other level 3 focus decks that I really think it would have just had a tremendous impact on the format had we had it for the national season or even for some YCSs prior to that. But most notably, the card that we are still missing from the first Link Reigns pack is Crisstron Needlefiber. Now, a lot of people are kind of okay with the fact that we don't have Needlefiber, and I'm kind of in that camp too, because Needlefiber, if we're talking about format warping cards, this is one of the most degenerate, absurd cards ever printed. And if you go to Japan and you look at Japan's like deck lists and just see how the decks work, Needlefiber is essentially just the linchpin that is just all these decks are centralized around, because they're able to play tuners that are able to do just absurd things. Glow Up Bowl becomes a one card link four. Like, it just does things that are just so absurdly broken, and a lot of people are excited about that, but at the same time, it's a very polarizing opinion because a lot of people really don't want this card kind of lingering in the format. So it's one of those things where we still don't have it yet, but Konami's probably just waiting for that right opportunity so that they're going to be able to release it, maybe to help sell a set that might not do as well or a product that might do as well. And it's basically creating a wider chasm between the TCG and OCG formats. And I feel like the wider that chasm becomes also increases the tension and kind of the resentment we have towards Konami as well, because why do we not have these cards yet? I think the fact that it's been over a year is just ridiculous. And now you're announcing the fact that you're making a second pack that not only is this just a second product, but it's a second iteration of a product that had such a tremendous impact on the game, especially at a competitive level, that now you're just gonna announce it and we still don't have all the cards from the first pack? I think that's just outrageous. The longer we wait, the larger the divide is going to become, and we stray further and further away from the OCG's format, and it's like we're not even playing the same game anymore. You know, we look at the OCG's format and we get excited about some of the cards that we see coming out, especially in core sets, because we know we're gonna be receiving those cards rather soon. But when it comes to something like the Link Reigns pack and Konami of America decides, oh, we're just gonna break it up and throw it into a bunch of other products, you're not gonna know when you're gonna get them, but you'll get them soon. It kind of just leaves a sour taste in the player base's mouth, and it's something that I'm not personally a fan of. Now, we've talked about Link Reigns Pack 1 enough. Let's talk about Link Reigns Pack 2, because the crazy thing about this set is, if the first Link Reigns Pack had such a tremendous impact on the game, what's the second pack gonna do? I mean, are we gonna get a Paleozoic Link monster? Are we gonna get a true Draco Link monster? A dinosaur Link monster? What about Infernoid or Infernity? We've got Necroz, Satellar Knight. There's so many archetypes that are like on the fringe of being competitively viable, or even are competitively viable even without their own dedicated Link monster. So just imagine what those decks would be like if they had their own semi-broken Link monster that they could incorporate into their strategy that helped facilitate all the deck's plays without taking anything away from it. That's a really crazy and scary thought, but it sounds like it could be absolutely fantastic. And if we're gonna be getting 20 more Link monsters like we did in the first Link Reigns pack, that means that like anything is up for grabs in terms of what decks or archetypes they're going to decide to support. And I think that's what's the most exciting thing about that is, with Link Reigns Pack 2 coming, that means we could have so many more older archetypes being supported that who knows what's going to be in the meta maybe a few months from now once Link Reigns Pack 2 finally gets released. But the biggest gripe that I still have with this is that for Japan, this is amazing, but for us here in the TCG, we don't know when we're going to get these cards, and it could be another year, it could be another 2 years, and by just furthering that divide and creating even more dissonance between us and the OCG, I think it just makes us sad that we don't get these cards at the same time, or nearly at a pace that's, you know, acceptable for us to receive these cards. I mean, we want to play with Cherubini, we want to play with Jasmine, we want to play with Needlefiber. We just don't have them yet, so having another set that's going to have the impact that it will, like Link Reigns Pack 2, has me really excited, but at the same time, I really just hope that, you know, they give us all the cards at once. And I know that's very optimistic thinking. They're probably just gonna piece it up again like they do with Link Reigns Pack 1. But in a perfect world, imagine if we got that second Link Reigns Pack just all at once. Do you guys remember the excitement when the first Link Reigns Pack was out and people were just scrambling to find videos of it being opened on YouTube? That's because the set was amazing. It not only had amazingly powerful Link monsters, but it had really good reprints of competitive cards that helped supplement those Link monsters in general, and it was just a home run in terms of a product. And I would really love to have that excitement for the product if it were actually released in the TCG, rather than hoping someone imports it here for us to open. But guys, those are just my thoughts. Let me know down in the comments what you guys think about Link Vrain's Pack 2. I'd really love to hear your thoughts, because I'd really love to know what archetypes you think will be supported, because there's a lot that they could go with, and it'd be really cool to see how creative they can get. But guys, thank you so much for watching the video. Be sure to like the video as always. Subscribe to the channel for more amazing Yu-Gi-Oh! Content. And if you found this video informative, consider becoming a YouTube channel member, because by becoming a channel member and showing your support, you're enabling my ability to continue bringing you amazing Yu-Gi-Oh! Content. So thanks so much again, and we'll see you next time.